Kalasha people, more than 4,000 people are living in this backward area, Rumbur, Brumbret, and Birir. And we are having our unique culture, traditional, festivals, ceremonies, and still we celebrate in this area.
Okay, this is a big headdress that's used for some special vacations like funerals and festivals.
Yes, it's really heavy.
Yes, yes, so they can wear it on top of the small one.
Gosh.
And these days, flood destroyed our many, valuable things in this area, especially in Rumbur and Birir, Brumbret. Three valleys have been affected badly. Much, landslided and break the glacier. And glacier came to the water, and water become a flood. So it came down with the big stones, big trees. And it was, a tragic moment for us to see this kind of dangerous thing. It was at night time. Otherwise, when it was in daytime, many people will be heart attack and they died because of these tragic moments.
So about the Kalash, these were the people who once ruled Chitral. And they had a territory of over 16,000 square kilometers, whereas now the same people are restricted to just three small valleys, and their total population isn't more than 4,000 people. But having said that, they're still very special people in the sense that in Pakistan they're still following their own religion, they're following their own customs. It also goes to the credit of the government of Pakistan that they are not disturbed so far. Whereas the same tribe who used to be in Afghanistan, they were all forcibly converted by the king of Afghanistan, Amir Abdur Rahman. And here in Pakistan, they still are like they used to be 100 years or more ago. Now the issue with them is that we're all worried, even here, all of us in Chitral, that the few 4,000 people that have been left, they might get converted also, not because anyone is forcibly converting them. There is, yes, a certain degree of missionaries who think that they take it upon themselves, both Christians and Muslims, to convert people who are not what they call followers of the book, because the Kalash, their religion is worshipping their ancestors, their religion is worshipping nature, and they don't follow a particular book, they don't have the Quran, they don't have the Bible. So some of these missionaries think that they probably will find themselves a place in heaven if they can convert some of these poor Kalash people. But that isn't as worrisome because there are only few. They are in a way protected by the government of Pakistan. What is worrisome is that some of these difficult traditions that the Kalash have, for example, if there is a wedding, they have to sacrifice that many goats, which could be anything from 20 to 40. And similarly, if there's a death in the family, they have to sacrifice the same amount of goats. Now this is becoming very difficult economically for them. So the easiest thing for them is to convert and say that we don't have to do this because we have become Muslims. So it is this that has got to be kept in mind in order to help them to retain their flavor and retain their customs and retain the way they are by helping them out economically. Tourism was doing this to a certain extent, but now the tourists are no longer visible in Pakistan. many of the small hotels where these backpackers used to come and stay are all empty. What were there have been taken away by the recent floods. So these are all very difficult things, and someone should take note of this. In my own small little capacity, I contacted the UNICEF, and I asked them if they can help us to make the Kalash Valleys a World Heritage Site. And if that happens, then new rules will have to be followed, and they will be protected a bit more than what they are protected now. So things like these should be thought about and steps taken in that direction.
Every year, last year we had the average of tourists were more than 5,000 and a half. And we had attended 5,600 tourists among 80 foreigners. And this year, because of the flood, we have only 3,000 tourists visited museum. And it's a kind of a loss for us as well.
Yes.
Because, you know, tourists can bring some money for the people, for the locals.
Yes, of course.
So because of this flood and this opportunity have been also lost.
Mm-hmm.
And we are actually hoping for the next years if we could make some good things that can... We can, you know, invite tourists for this.
Yes, well, at least you're opened up now, the road, because that stopped anybody getting
The thing is that now FWO, the Federal Working Unit, took responsibility to make this road. I hope for the next years they will complete it.
Yeah.
For 2006, we will have a very good road, and we can put in the internet all these things that for the next year, all the tourists should come and visit us.
We hope so, yes. And special events to attract people back.
It was a very, very difficult trek at that time when flood came.
Yes.
And many people were, affected because the road, especially you saw downside there, it was broken and it, reached near the mountain. So now I hope they can cut the mountain and make a very good trek for the next year.
Yes.
Requested to the tourism departments to make offices near these valleys to guide the tourists that which is the place to go there, which is the place to not go there. So this it can help us to guide the people, and the people can also know about our culture. This is a unique culture, and if a person comes here and gets a guide from downside and he does not understand anything, so it's a kind of he just came here and he learned nothing and went back. So small offices can help the tourists to guide about our culture and guide about our area as well.
What are the biggest sort of factors, risks of the Kalashi people? Is it commercialization, Muslim communities moving into the valleys, just modern life, the internet?
The thing is that, these modern things can guide our people to get interest of our culture. Nowadays, the educated students are very interested to participate in all the events. We are just thinking that we should have at least some separate schools which can help us to guide the students about our culture, about our traditions.
We are building it. So in 2013, some landslide came, it destroyed half of the school. Then this year in July, again some landslides destroyed completely the school. So now the students are studying in the tents, and some of them studying in the temple called Jestakhan there.
Look at the chook.
Yes.
I'm
I didn't know it was. Then later on, I just did some visitors, I swear.
And says there will be a school, but it will take time, yes. Maybe 1 or 2 years, yes. Slowly.
Well, not 2 years, but we think...
More than 1 year and a half, 2 years. Some.
So this is the class for the English lesson. The alphabet will start from class first class up to class 5. So this is the student of class 4. This is the student of second class. There's some dry red beans, tomatoes, walnuts, and 4 or 5 different kind of beans that we dry them for the winter, and also mulberries that we dry and use them in the winter time. Yes.
So they put them in for dry, so now the weather is a bit raining, so collect them.
A typical Kalashi house, and for that matter a typical Chitrali house of the old days, consisted of only one room, and that room would be used as a bedroom, it would be used as a kitchen, it would be used as a store place, and it would be used as a guest room too. Now the room would have just one source of ventilation, which would be a hole in the roof. There would be no windows, and that was mainly because to keep the warmth in, and it, of course, also it was as a result they had a lot of eye trouble because of the smoke that would emit from the room in winters.
If you feel like you can get someone serving here, sometimes included. The headdress is also.
Yes, beautiful.